So this is a Meet the Author event, and it's a great pleasure to have Nicholas Hagger as the author this evening. He's written 46 books, and many of those books, he was explaining to me, have been influenced, of course, by his life in education, his travel, and so on, which he'll be and experiences into philosophy and so on, which he'll be talking about. But also, much of it goes back, he was saying, to his experience in this part of the world, that he's lived in Loughton and in this area of Essex. Or it first came here in 1943, and has moved on in that time, but something has always kept bringing you back. So perhaps we're going to hear more about that when the talk gets going. Nicholas is going to talk for about 45 minutes, and then there'll be plenty of chance to ask questions afterwards.
I'm grateful to the Loughton Festival for inviting me, and I'm pleased to be here in Wesley Hall. Some of you may remember my aunt, Margaret Broadley, who attended Loughton Methodist Church and died in 1998. Lord Murray and I read lessons at the memorial service in this church. She was assistant matron at the London Hospital, and here she is with me in 1940 when I was living with my grandmother in East Grinstead. And this is when she laid the foundation stone of the new Methodist Church in Loughton in 1986. The 30th anniversary of this church was celebrated this last weekend, and I believe this picture has been up in the foyer until very recently. She was asked to lay the new foundation stone because when the old church was demolished, under the old foundation stone, laid in 1903, there was a copy of a Methodist recorder containing an announcement of her birth. She didn't know of the existence of this church until my father came here in 1942. I understand that copy of the Methodist recorder is under the new foundation stone of the new church. So in the picture, I'm in the front with my wife Anne and son Tony, and my sister is next to him. Somebody spoke to me just now about my sister, and you may recognise my sister with her two young children next to him. Lord Murray is standing at the back. Well, today I'm giving you an overview of my literary life, an introduction to my works and to how they were inspired by Epping Forest. So I was born in 1939, and here I am at my christening with my father, who was in local government and died in 1963. My mother was a violinist who later taught the violin, here shown in the 1930s. She died in 1982, some of you may remember. I came to Loughton during the war in March 1943. My father was already here, so we joined him. Here I am, aged 4 on the left, at our new home, 52 Brooklyn Avenue, a walking distance from here, after windows were blown out by a string of German bombs that fell on Loughton Cricket Field in March 1944. I'm holding a piece of glass I'd picked up. At the time, I was leaving the house of my father to walk to the post office, which in those days was opposite trees. And even now, I can remember at the gate, it was dusk, and there was a flash, a white flash, and everything was lit up as bright as day, about 5 in the afternoon. And it's like the tube train that goes over an intersection, and there's a great flash, just like that. That had consequences, because the bombs damaged the nearby school I was attending, Essex House in Loughton Highway, long since replaced by the olive tree. In fact, it's so nearby that it's actually next door. Well, this is 260 High Road, and that's 258. And so, for the last days of the spring term 1944, we were relocated to the school hall at this church, which must have been about where we're sitting now. Essex House, Loughton, then closed because of the bomb damage. And I moved across the road to the old Oakton School on the corner of Traps Hill, here shown front and back. It too had been damaged by the same bombs. And the first day of the summer term, on my first day at my new school, our classes were back again in this church's school hall, right here, where we are now. And that school hall was sadly destroyed by a bomb on the 19th of April, 1944, after we'd gone back to the old Oaklands. So I was actually in two kindergartens within a month, near where I'm talking now, so this feels like a bit of a homecoming. I heard Winston Churchill speak from the Loughton War Memorial in April 1945. He was RMP. I was being held up level with his shoulder just on the left of the picture. In fact, my mother and father used to say that my head's in the picture, but I can't actually see it. I think they might have mistaken me for a hat. Anyway, I was close enough to touch him, and he told us that if he was called away during the coming general election, Mrs. Churchill would look after the constituency. He was called away to Potsdam, and he heard that he had lost the general election, so this photo was taken near the end of his wartime premiership. He actually came back to Loughton in 1951 during the election, and I got his autograph by standing on the top step at Loughton High School. And he signed W. Churchill and beamed at me and shook my hand. That will be relevant later. After the war, we moved to Journey's End, 27 Station Road, Loughton, here as it used to be, with lime trees along the front, which I had to keep cut with a long arm, one of those things that we do that to. My local bookshop was Addison's, now part of today's Loughton Barbecue, formerly Abbott's Travel, where you can see the plaque on the right. It was William Addison's bookshop, and I spent my first book token at his shop in May 1945 on my sixth birthday, when he had just finished his book on Epping Forest. He helped me buy the Observer's Book of Trees and set me on a course of getting to know Epping Forest. He actually said that. This will set you on a course to get to know Epping Forest. Oakland School relocated to Albion Hill, Loughton in September 1944, and I moved with it to the new Oaklands. This picture shows me in a school photograph in 1946. In the school holidays, I was sent to shop in the High Road. In those days, Loughton opposite St. Mary's looked like this. I bought potatoes from an open-air greengrocer's, which is in the middle of the picture, probably one of those awnings, kept by Gladys, who always wore mittens, a woolen hat, and a white work coat. I won't comment on how grubby or otherwise the white work coat was. I went to Chigwell School. I'm sitting front row in the centre in 1949, and second from the right in 1956. In 1953, Field Marshal Montgomery visited the school on a Sunday, and I was one of the few boys selected to speak with him, and that's relevant later. In 1957 and 1958, I played cricket for Buckhurstville First Eleven on the top ground opposite the Roebuck near Brayside Senior School. I'm fourth from the left at the back. In those pre-television days, when we played on a Saturday afternoon, people sat about four deep round the boundary. It was amazing to think that that was one of the focal points of what to do with a Saturday in those days. I read English literature at Oxford under Christopher Ricks, now one of the world's best known literary critics. I've stayed in touch with him throughout my literary life. On the left, I'm leaving for Oxford, and on the right, I'm with him in May 2009, after his last lecture as Oxford's Professor of Poetry, which I attended. I wanted to see the world, especially the ruins of past civilizations. Through the British Council, of course it's hard to travel in those days, the idea is you went and lived in the country and saw places and locations. So through the British Council, I spent a year lecturing in English literature at the University of Baghdad, Iraq, from 1961 to 1962. I visited Babylon, and during the vacation, Damascus, Jerusalem, and Beirut. Here I am in the center, sitting with one of my classes in the cafeteria. They all look very nice, and they're all Sunnis, Shiites, Kurds, living happily together. And I have to say that the leader of Islamic State, IS, al-Baghdadi, was a pupil at the same university in the 1990s. But nothing I said in the 1960s encouraged that. Back in Essex, I frequently visited Epping Forest. I often went to the Earl's Path Pond at the end of Forest Road on the left, and then to the Strawberry Hill Pond on the right. I was appointed a professor of English literature at three universities in Tokyo, Japan. I visited the Strawberry Hill Pond shortly before I left for Japan. The sky was reflected in the water, and I could see the ground as well as the sky and my own reflection, and I had a profound sense of the unity of the universe. This found its way into several of my poems. I was in Japan for 4 years, from 1963 to 1967. I began writing poems seriously there. I had lunch with the Suffolk poet Edmund Blunden when he visited Tokyo, and I met Japan's T.S. Eliot, Junzaburo Nishiwaki, in a small restaurant with sawdust on the floor, drinking sake. I asked how he would sum up the wisdom of the East, and he wrote on a card I've still got on my wall, shown on the right, plus A plus minus A equals zero. I understood that all contradictions are reconciled in a unity. Day plus night, life and death, time and eternity, youth and age, war and peace, and so on. Plus A plus minus A, whatever opposites or contradictions, they're reconciled in a fundamental unity. I was also tutor to Emperor Hirohito's second son, Prince Itachi. He didn't know, and I had to explain, that people pay income tax. He said, "You mean they take money from your salary? That's terrible." I taught him the history of all civilizations and planned his state visit to the UK in 1965. Here I am with Prince and Princess Itachi in August 1965. We're in the grounds of his palace, and there were nesting boxes in the trees. I asked what was in them. He said, "My ancestors." It's Shinto belief that the past emperors come back and live in the palace grounds in nesting boxes. I visited China in 1966 and was the first to get wind of the Cultural Revolution. But that's another story. While in Japan, I wrote a longish poem on the silence, which includes many lines about Epping Forest and refers to Lopping Paul as a four-faced striking clock. I also included in the silence the stones and rocks of the stone garden in the Ryoanji Zen temple in Kyoto. The monks rake the stones every day, and the stones represent earth, sea, air and clouds. The rocks represent rocks in the sea and mountains. The stone garden is saying that all existence is one, a unity. It's all one stuff. In the image, stones, but in actuality, not stones, but something else. I came back from Japan on leave in 1966 with a strong sense of the unity of the universe, which I had originally found in Epping Forest. I visited the stubbles, which in those days was a heath full of grasshoppers and hazy blues, and brought the stubbles into a poem, An Inner Home, which says I would always be enfolded in this forest, in this unchangeable image of an inner home. That poem's first section is about Waltham Abbey, which I also visited. I was interested in Harold II, who rebuilt it in 1060, before he was defeated at Hastings. I spent 2 years in Tripoli, Libya, as lecturer in English literature at the University of Libya, and witnessed the Gaddafi Revolution. I drove to work on the morning of the revolution, on 1st of September 1969, in my green Volkswagen Beetle. And it was the only car on the road. I couldn't understand why. I had the road to myself. The university gates were closed, and then I saw a soldier who raised his rifle and shot in the air. So I turned round and went back home, and the revolution came towards me, tanks and armed cars. So I preceded the revolution and had to go back through it. So I sort of slid down in my seat to make myself small, and when I saw a tank coming, I turned left, and I saw an armed car, I turned right, and wove my way through and got back safely. I didn't know it, but Gaddafi was in a blue beetle. So there were two beetles on the street. I was in the green one, he was in the blue one. My daughter Nadia, who is here, had a toy gun, and we were told that Gaddafi's army would be searching foreigners' apartments for guns. And she heard this and hid her toy gun in one of her welly boots. I travelled across the Sahara Desert, and here I am standing beside the grave of a Bedouin, just a few stones. By then I had begun 4 years' work as a British intelligence agent, the years before the UK entered the European community. On my way home in 1970, I visited the poet Ezra Pound in Rapallo, Italy. He was very famous, the father of modernism. He amended T.S. Eliot's The Wasteland. He was the leader of the modernist movement in poetry in the around 1920, before and after. And I spent a whole evening discussing epic poetry with him, how to write a long poem in the tradition of Homer, Virgil and Milton, and an idea I had for an epic poem on the Second World War. He had spent 60 years writing one poem, the Cantos, and the manuscript of the latest canto was on the table where he sat. He was then aged 84, and we talked until midnight. He died when he was 85. From 1970 to 1981, I lived in London, but often visited Epping Forest. In the early 1970s, I worked for The Times, and I wrote several articles about Africa in relation to the Cold War for the features editor and later editor, Charles Douglas Hume, nephew of Sir Alec Douglas Hume, who was Prime Minister in the 60s. I eventually became Head of English and Seamen Teacher at a large school in Wandsworth for 11 years. The A-level English literature classes I taught went well with the poems I was writing, including poems about Epping Forest. In 1970, I'd written A Green Country, four poems about High Beach Church, shown on the left. In 1972, Time and Eternity, and The Bride of Time, in which I speak of leaping this three stone-stepped stile in the churchyard at High Beach Church. And you can see the three steps of the stile, which is still there in the churchyard at High Beach Church. In 1974, I wrote High Beach Church, and again in 1974, A Crocus in the Churchyard. And in 1974 again, a poem on Journey's End, on the right, Pear Ripening House, because we had pear trees in our back garden. And also in 1974, a poem on Earl's Path Pond, Clouded Ground Pond, in which I see the unity of the universe, the ground, the sky, and my reflection. And just as an observation, in Taoism in the East, in China and Japan, there's a view that a trinity or a triad, that the universe is heaven, earth, and man, and they're all those three united. And I can see now, I meant to have been aware at the time, that when I was focusing on the sky, the ground, and my reflection in a pond, actually, very Taoist, very Far Eastern. So all these poems are at the back of a view of Epping Forest. I returned to live near Epping Forest in 1982, having acquired Oakton School in Loughton, seen here from two angles, my own school. I became principal. My wife became headmistress. Here she is in 1982 with her predecessor, who invited us to take over, Elizabeth Lord. Some of you may remember her. In 1988, I founded Coopersale Hall School in Epping, which opened in 1989. I became principal. I'm shown above in 1988, before it actually opened. While I was setting up Coopersale Hall, I was working on two books whose covers are on the right. A selection of my poems, selected poems, A Metaphysical Way of Fire at the top, and a study of the history of civilizations the fire and the stones. The fire in both cases is reality, the inner light, the fire of reality that is known in metaphysics. Arguably, civilizations begin with a vision of this fire. So Muhammad sees the fire in the cave and writes the Quran, and on page one, it's the fire. And Islam grows out of it, and the Arab civilization grows out of that, and so on with all civilizations. There was a combined launch at the Museum of London in 1991. Speakers included the historian Asa Briggs, who's speaking on the left, and two poets sitting beside him, Kathleen Rain and David Gascoigne. I see all history as a unity, and the history book has a 7-foot-long chart of 25 civilizations, which includes all world history. Each civilization goes through the same 61 stages. The poet Ted Hughes wrote to me that I had discovered the law of history. I've actually brought a copy, and it's spread out on the back there, just near to the right of where the books are, so you can take a look later. 25 civilizations down on the left, 61 stages across, and it predicts that communism would end in 1991 in the Soviet Union. My study of history confirmed my worldview that everything is a unity, which I first glimpsed in the Epping Forest Ponds. The introduction to the Fire and the Stones is titled Introduction to the New Universalism. Universalism is a worldview that embraces the unity of the universe and the whole of humankind, and it's in an image on a later book cover showing the one universe shaped like a shuttlecock, and you can see the Big Bang at the bottom, and the universe fans out as it expands, and it's still expanding now, and more of that later on. But the shape of the universe is like a shuttlecock. This worldview has consequences in several disciplines. Philosophy is no longer about words and logic, but about humankind in relation to the universe, as it was to the early Greeks. History is no longer about slices of history in different countries, but about the history of humankind and all the 25 civilizations seen as a whole, as on the chart. Literature is about all world literature. Religion is about the essence of all religions, the fire or divine light, which is found in every religion. International politics is about the political unity of all humankind. So this is a very revolutionary concept, which changes everything in several disciplines. I saw I would have to work out this one perception in 7 disciplines. I'm jumping ahead to show you a recent book cover, My Double Life 2, A Rainbow Over the Hills, which shows a rainbow over Epping Forest. The 7 interconnected bands of the rainbow stand for the 7 interconnected disciplines in which I've written. Mysticism, literature, philosophy and the sciences, history, comparative religion, international politics and statecraft, world culture. From now, although literature is my main discipline, my published works are in one or more of these 7 interconnected disciplines, like the 7 bands of a rainbow, but it's one rainbow, even though there are 7 bands. I stated universalism in philosophy. In 1993, the universe and the light came out, doing just that. This includes a lecture I gave to a mystics and scientists conference for 500 in Winchester. In 1993 to 1994, I led 12 philosophers in developing universalism in philosophy. Universalism which sees the unity of the universe and all interconnected disciplines as a whole. The 12 philosophers met monthly, sometimes more frequently, in different parts of London, and I led them for 2 years. I got back to literature, poems, autobiography, and diaries, 3 books that came out in 1994. A White Radiance on the left, collected poems 1958 to 1993. A Mystic Way, autobiography, and Awakening to the Light, diaries 1958 to 1967. And I've always kept a page a day diary since about 1963, and there are many, many volumes of diaries. In 1966, I wrote my first short story, and after that I wrote many more. And in 1995, I brought out two volumes of short stories. A Spade Fresh with Mud, volume 1, on the left. A Smell of Leaves and Summer, volume 2. In all, 400 very short stories with vivid titles. Also in 1995, The Warlords, parts 1 and 2, that's two verse plays, came out. These two verse plays are about the Second World War from D-Day to the fall of Berlin, and the hero is Montgomery, and you'll see Churchill on the cover at the bottom. From 1995 to 1997, I brought out Overlord, about the last year of the Second World War, from D-Day to the fall of Berlin, in four separate volumes. Those are along the top. The idea I had discussed with Ezra Pound. The hero is Eisenhower. A one-edition volume appeared later. I discussed the meter I should use with my former tutor, Christopher Ricks. We walked around Oxford and decided in the end I should use blank verse, having looked at all the alternatives and eliminated them. Overlord has 41,000 lines of blank verse. Ricks became Professor of Poetry at Oxford in 2004, and I attended most of his termly lectures, including, as I have said, his last one on the 11th of May 2009, when this photo was taken. Ted Hughes, poet laureate during the 1990s, sent me letters and cards throughout most of the 1990s and was very interested in Overlord. This card says what a prodigious amount of work. In 1996, my wife and I acquired Normanhurst School in Chingford. Soon afterwards, my wife stopped being headmistress at Oakland's after 14 years and became a consultant at all three schools. We were then principals of all three schools. In 1997, we acquired Otley Hall in Suffolk, which you can see here with a moat, Tudor property, where Bartholomew Gosnold is thought to have planned voyages to America in 1602 to Martha's Vineyard, which was named after Martha, his one-year-old daughter, and 1606-7 to Jamestown. The settlement there is now regarded as marking the founding of America, and 2007, America celebrated its 400th anniversary based on the founding of Jamestown in 1607. So the Jamestown voyage is thought to have been planned from the Tudor hall that we had for 7 years in Suffolk. We ran it as a historic house for 7 years and had 40,000 visitors, including many Americans, including the First Lady of Virginia and so on, without living there. I made frequent visits. Some of my poems are set there. We had four casts of Globe actors to stay for several days and rehearse there, including Mark Rylance and Vanessa Redgrave. And they invited me to their evening feasts. I told Rylance off for getting himself buried near the front gate when he was playing Hamlet, because he wanted to experience to be or not to be by lying in a grave with earth pressing on his chest. I said, if you died, it might have caused huge problems with Otley Hall's insurance. Rylance was a bit unworldly and didn't think of things like insurance. They invited me to join their rehearsals. They dressed me as a priest, and I had to marry Gertrude and Claudius. We were doing all the bits that Shakespeare didn't write, the in-between bits, to help the actors perform and play. And I carried a standard across a local farmer's field in the battle that defeated Brutus in Julius Caesar. I was told to arm myself, and I went to the kitchen and came back with a meat cleaver, but that was disqualified as being too dangerous on health and safety grounds. In 1999, while supervising Notley Hall, I brought out Morlocks, The Tragedy of Prince Tudor, a verse play, Wheeling Bats and the Harvest Moon, Short Stories, Volume 3, The Warm Glow of the Monastery Courtyard, Short Stories, Volume 4, The One and the Many, which is philosophy, and this includes a lecture I gave at Aldborough, Suffolk, A Revolution in Thought and Culture. In 2001, my son Matthew, who is here at the back, joined me in the schools and worked alongside me while I gradually took a step back for him to do the day-to-day. That gave me time to write on the background to the contemporary history of Western civilization. In 2004, The Syndicate came out on influential elites seeking to control the world's energy resources from 1900 to 2003. As you're probably aware, they control all the gas and oil pipelines today, and all the wars are about gas and oil pipelines, including Syria, which is about two competing natural gas pipelines, one Russian-backed and one American-backed. In 2005, The Secret History of the West, on secret organizations from 1453 to 1920. And in 2006, The Light of Civilization, on the experience of the inner light, the fire, in all civilizations within history, mysticism, and comparative religion. And to me that's important because I argue that every civilization, all the 25 civilizations, have begun with this experience. I've been asked to prepare my collected literary works, another reason I took a step back from the schools. In 2006-07, five volumes of my collected works came out. In 2006, Classical Odes, 318 odes written between 1994 and 2005. And in those odes you'll find many Brexit, pro-Brexit, and some pro-Remain. So it's across the board, because I believe that the poet has to hold the mirror up to society and include the lot. Overlord, the one-volume edition, 41,000 lines, as I've said. Collected Poems, 1958 to 2005, that was 1,478 poems. And in 2007, Collected Verse Plays, five plays about different aspects of government, including world rule. Collected Stories, 1 to 5. So there are 1,001 stories in the collected stories, and it's 1,001 stories like the Arabian Nights. So getting all that together was full time, and it took a lot of hard work, all editing and searching through manuscripts and finding them and so on, took a long time. My wife and I moved from Albion Hill, Loughton to Bacchus Hill, and we now overlooked Epping Forest. This is the view that was on the screen at the beginning, a view over part of Henry VIII's 300-acre deer park that covered Fairmead Bottom, which was cleared in 1540 to 1543. So Henry had that cleared, Fairmead Bottom cleared, and it was linked to what is now Queen Elizabeth's hunting lodge, which was originally Henry VIII's hunting lodge, linked to that deer park. I focused on history and eyewitness history. In 2007, The Secret Founding of America came out, American history based on the founding of America from Otley Hall, in other words, the planning of the Jamestown settlement voyage, the first book in my American trilogy. In 2008, The Last Tourist in Iran, eyewitness history, written after my visit to Iran in 2007. I was the only tourist in Iran, which is why the title is The Last Tourist. I made it my business to do a tour when Bush was reported to be about to bomb it, and nobody else was there. I had Persepolis entirely to myself. The Rise and Fall of Civilizations, History, updating my study of civilizations. And in 2009, the Libyan Revolution, eyewitness history, which drew on my experiences of the Gaddafi revolution, including when I was told I was going to be executed and had to talk my way out of it for 3 hours in the middle of the night, but that's in the book. I returned to philosophy. In 2009, the new philosophy of universalism came out. It is a new philosophy, and a revolution in philosophy. So it's within philosophy and the sciences. The cover shows the expanding universe I was describing earlier, the Big Bang at the bottom, and the universe fans upward and outward, and it's still expanding, like a wave. And so we've got a surfer at the top, and the surfer's enlarged on the right, so you can see it. So the universe is expanding, and the surfer's on the edge, surfing. Okay, in philosophy you can read about Zeno's, that's Z-E-N-O, Zeno's paradoxes, philosophical conundrums. This is one of Hagger's paradoxes. The surfer's ankles are in finite space-time, because the universe is expanding and his ankles are part of the expansion. Where is the rest of him? Answer, he's in the infinite. The rest of him is in the infinite, which surrounds and permeates space-time. So space-time, this shuttlecock shape, this expansion, is within the infinite. But the infinite also permeates it. And this is the philosophy of universalism, one aspect of it. So the surfer represents humankind in the infinite, but also in space-time. I turned to epic poetry again, and in 2010 brought out a second epic poem. This is in the tradition of Homer, Virgil and Milton. Armageddon, about the war on terror. 9/11 and the wars in Afghanistan and Iraq. The hero is George W. Bush. It has 25,000 lines of blank verse. And I've shown this picture of Christopher Ricks already. I was near the end of Armageddon when this was taken on the 11th of May 2009. Steeped in the war on terror, I now considered how to make the world free from war. Having experienced it as a boy and seen at the windows blown out and having written about it, the Second World War, and now the war on terror, and I focused on international politics and statecraft and on the universalist approach to a world state. In 2010, I brought out The World Government, a work of philosophy and statecraft on the possibility of a coming democratic world state that is strong enough to abolish war, enforce disarmament, and bring in universal peace. And more of that later. In 2011, I brought out The Secret American Dream, on American history, the second in my American trilogy. Obama's on the cover, and the publisher asked me to send Obama a copy. I went onto the White House's website to report that a book would be coming, and my details came up, already known, already there in the White House records, with my phone number given as my PA's mobile number, which completely spooked her, and she's here to witness it at the front. And thank you very much for your help with all this input. Thank you. The Secret American Dream is to export the American dream of American prosperity to all humankind, so everyone benefits from it. I got back to literature and saw all world literature as a whole, the universalist approach to world literature. In 2012, I brought out a new philosophy of literature on the fundamental theme of world literature, and that's a lecture in itself. So I won't embark on what it is now. But the cover shows the light and the shadow in the pediment at Copt Hall, again, Epping Forest in the background in the cover. I now turned to local history. In 2012, I brought out a view of Epping Forest. This is a unified view of Epping Forest in the tradition of William Addison. Remember his bookshop at the beginning, when I was six, and he wrote that book was shown on the right, Epping Forest, in 1945. Came out in 1946. I had to do it in 6 months, so the book could be out for the 2012 London Olympic Games, Epping Forest being near Stratford. There's Earl Harold, Harold II of the Battle of Hastings, owned four manors in Loughton. Luckington, as it was called then, L-U-K-I-N-T-O-N-E. So he owned the four manors from when Edward the Confessor gave them to him until 1060, when Harold gave them to all from Holy Cross. King Harold of the Battle of Hastings was our local landlord before 1060. So Loughton has a very special connection with Harold, and we need to bear that in mind and take it on board. And the details are in the book at the back. At the back of a view of Epping Forest, there are 25 of my poems that were inspired by Epping Forest places. Loughton, Chickwell, Waltham Abbey, High Beach, Epping, Faden, Chingford and Bacchus Hill. These include, and here are some titles, In Loughton Within Western Civilization, Among Loughton's Sacred Houses, In Addison's Essex, Oakland's Oak Tree, With Harold at Waltham, At Harold's Waltham Abbey, At Amesbury Banks, Epping, see the bottom picture. I'm writing the poem within Amesbury Banks on the 21st of July 2001. Filter taken by my daughter. Thank you very much indeed for taking that. Copt Hall, see the top right picture. Copt Hall Revisited. And at Queen Elizabeth's Hunting Lodge, see the top left picture. I now wrote two volumes of autobiography, which came out in 2015. My Double Life One, This Dark Wood, which covers from 1939 to 1973. This includes an account of my 4 years as a British intelligence agent. This Dark Wood echoes Dante, who was lost in a dark wood, but it also suggests Epping Forest. And My Double Life Two, A Rainbow Over the Hills, which covers from 1973 to 2014. The seven bands of the rainbow symbolise the seven disciplines in which I've written. And My Double Life in both titles refers to my life in education, most recently in Epping Forest, and my literary life. In 2015, the Hagger family acquired Brayside School on two sites in Bacchus Hill, our fourth school. My wife and I became principals. Our son Matthew, who is group managing principal, became working principal. The Oak Tree Group of Schools now had over 300 staff. In 2015 and 2016, I brought out 5 works of literature, including selected poems and selected stories to date, and new poems and new stories. In 2015, selected stories, Follies and Vices of the Modern Elizabethan Age, a selection of short stories from volumes 1 to 5. Selected poems, Quest for the One, a selection of poems from 1958 to 2010, and The Dream of Europa, a mask, a kind of verse play, celebrating 70 years of peace in Europe. In 2016, Life Cycle and Other New Poems, 2006 to 2016, and The First Dazzling Chill of Winter, volume 6 of my short stories. So the 6 volumes cover 6 decades, and the chill of winter sort of means that we're sort of approaching old age. I turned to international politics and statecraft, and in 2016 brought out the third book in my American trilogy, The Secret American Destiny. The cover shows the subtitle, which refers to the 7 disciplines of world culture, the 7 disciplines I've worked with. I sent the book to Trump at Trump Tower in New York before his inauguration, and he referred to the American destiny as an idea twice in his inauguration speech. At the same time, The Secret Founding of America, the first in my American trilogy, was reissued with a new cover. In 2016, my archive of papers and manuscripts was taken by the University of Essex, the Albert Sloan Library. And there's a website. to look at the catalogue. 54 boxes are there with more to follow. And my archive is a special collection along with the archive of Archbishop Parsonet, founder of Chipwell School in 1629, who's also there as a special collection. Also in 2016, I was awarded the Goosey Peace Prize for Literature and received it in Manila in the Philippines last November. The Goosey Prize has been called the Asian Nobel Prize, and about 15 laureates a year receive a prize within all disciplines and all nationalities. I'm only the third UK citizen to receive a Goosey Award since the awards began in 2002. I understand the award was connected with my being the only 21st century Western literary author to have continued the tradition of Truman, Einstein, Churchill, Eisenhower, Gandhi, Russell, Kennedy and Gorbachev in calling for a world state in some of my literary works, including my two epic poems. In Athens, in October 2015, I had chaired the World Philosophical Forum's Constitutional Convention and brought in, co-founded with a Russian, a world state, the universal state of the earth, which I see as an online dress rehearsal for a worldwide, properly democratic world state that would incorporate the UN. In my acceptance speech in Manila, and that's the three pictures on the left, that was before 7,000 people, I called for a democratic world state, a United Federation of the World, UF, to replace the UN, to implement political universalism. I said the UN has failed to prevent 162 wars since 1945. That's in my lifetime, 162 wars since that picture of me as a boy at the beginning. And it's failed to prevent 15,375 nuclear weapons, which is what it was in November. It's down a bit now, 14,900. It was 69,000 in about 1986. So the UN has not done a good job, I have to say. And there must be a better way to make a safer world for our school children and grandchildren. On the right, I'm standing under a billboard showing pictures of the 2016 laureates. There are many pictures and two videos of my visit to Manila on my website. I wrote about all this in two more books within international politics and statecraft
that will be out in 2018.
Peace for Our Time, a reflection on war and peace and a third world war. I was asked by a Syrian diplomat in Manila to undertake a peace mission to Assad of Syria, and the book contains my 15-point peace plan. And World State, an authoritative work on a democratic United Federation of the World aimed at the UN. Alongside this will be my constitution
for the United Federation of the World, which has 145 articles.
Before I went to Manila, I was asked to present an oil painting to the Goosey Museum in Manila, showing the Epping Forest countryside. And I consulted various people in Latin. I found and presented to the Goosey Museum this oil painting of a stag in Epping Forest at Fiddler's Hamlet, near where I founded Cooper Sarah Hall School in 1988. And on the right, I'm presenting that oil painting to Ambassador Goosey of the Goosey Foundation. Well, the artist of this picture of the stag, which is now in Manila, is Faden Constantine, and he's here. And it's a brilliant picture, and Ambassador Goosey said he loves it, and it really broke my heart handing it over for £2 I didn't come back. But we'll talk about that later. The stag is my trademark because of its two branched antlers. As a paragraph in Peace for Our Time makes clear, one of its antlers symbolises my works in seven disciplines: mysticism, literature, philosophy, the sciences, history, comparative religion, international politics and statecraft, and world culture. Now the other antler, also branched, symbolises my literary works within seven branches of literature. Poems and poetic epics, verse plays and masks, short stories and novellas, diaries, autobiographies, letters, and my statement of the fundamental theme of world literature. Two antlers may also suggest my double life, education and literature. My main area of activity is a man of letters who's written over 2,000 poems, two epic poems, five verse plays, 1,200 short stories, two travelogues, three autobiographies, diaries, and selected letters still to come. So they'll be out probably next year. Now I'm back with the title of my talk, Epping Forest and a Literary Life. I preside over four schools round Epping Forest. In a long literary life, I've written 46 books and have caught the unity of the universe and of humankind throughout the world from my own experience in seven different disciplines, which are interconnected like the seven bands in a rainbow, primarily in literature. I've tried to show what's gone wrong with the world and how to achieve universal peace and a better world for our school children and grandchildren. As I've tried to explain, Epping Forest has inspired my universalist vision of unity. Thank you for your attention.